This morning, I know we usually start off with Eye of the Tiger, but they played this on the Gross Call for Keller Williams, and it got me going. So I really, it's a great song. Awesome. Okay, so we are going to get started. There is going to be a lot to cover, you guys. We are officially at the last day of January, and this has been an exciting kind of month. There's been a lot going on, and so I think it's always important to acknowledge that. I think Brandy shared something at the team meeting that I thought was, how do I put it? I think it was very relevant, very, you know, great for the time. You know, it's something that I think we always have to acknowledge. Obviously, within the past you know, a couple months, we've experienced kind of this resurgence of COVID-19 and everything that kind of comes on around with that and the different variants. And it seems like December, January, a lot of people got hit with it, including myself, right? And so I think it's really important to just acknowledge that, you know, same thing where we say, hey, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now, is if you were kind of thrown off your game this year, if you were like, hey, I really want to start strong, and things shifted because of everything going on with the pandemic, that's okay. We want to give ourselves some grace and get restarted, right? We can always start again, and we always have a new day in front of us. So I just wanted to acknowledge that, because I know everybody's going through different things at home, and I think it's important for us to look at that. With that being said, we are going to go ahead and jump into the information today. So a couple things that I want to know right away. We are going to start with the market update. We're going to go through LA, Orange, San Bernardino, and Riverside counties. We're going to go through our updates. Then we're going to go through a couple of industry updates. There was some really interesting things that have happened over the last 2 weeks, including we're going to talk about the rent moratorium in Los Angeles County. We know that that's been extended. So we want to talk about that. I also want to talk about some very interesting things that are going on in the world of cryptocurrency as it relates to real estate, right? As it relates to real estate, I think that's always important for us to see as there's these different industry shifts, as there's these different technologies that kind of come into play. It's important for us to just kind of look at that and know what's going on. So we'll talk a little bit about that today, and I'll share some articles, some new stuff that's kind of been up for us today. All right, so let's go ahead and dig right in. Starting off, you guys know anytime we start on our market and industry update, I always have to bring up the TCPA. As a reminder, I'm gonna share some scripts, some action items that you can take with your clients based on the information that we share. With that being said, please, please, please just make sure that you are having your scripts let your lists scrubbed, that you are not calling anybody on the DNC, and that you are obtaining and confirming consent. I'm gonna note, I talk about database a lot. We are in a kind of interesting time where TCPA is so big right now. The reason that I think, you know, the more we talk about database and all these things is so important is because we're in this kind of stage before this becomes super normalized, right? It is highly likely that in the next 5 to 10 years, when we look at things like any sort of telemarketing calls and texts, that at some point they will likely be obsolete, right? We see that those kind of shifts that happen. And so right now, more than ever before, is the opportunity that we have to lead with value, to lead with being the expert of choice, so that we can obtain and get that consent to be in contact with individuals so that we become that realtor, that expert of choice for them. So just a reminder, my friends. All right, so jumping right in. Now, I'm going to note, because we're looking at kind of month to date, today is not included, meaning we're looking at the dates from the 1st through the 30th compared to the 1st through the 30th of last month. So we're going to be looking at that data as we go through. We're starting off with our Los Angeles County sales trends. I want you to pay attention as we go through these numbers. Look at where's the green, right? Look at where's the red. What are some of the trends that we're going to see across these four counties here? To go ahead and start, we look at month over month. We have seen an uptick in the number of properties for sale. This had not been completely in the green, but we started to see that uptick, right? We can see right over here, the last couple months, the number of properties for sale, we've seen a little bit of a decrease here. We're seeing a little bit of an uptick from where we were at this same time period. I want you to see this, right? So number of properties for sale from the 1st through the 31st of December, we ended that month in December at number of properties for sale, 4,506 in Los Angeles County. We are currently at 5,190, right? We're currently at 5,190. So no matter what, with today's data included in this, this number is going to stay in the green. In fact, it's up about 16% here. I'm guessing that we'll probably end a little bit higher. Why do I say that? We look at December. December the 31st would have been New Year's Eve, right? One day that is New Year's Eve in comparison to an actual Monday, like we have today for the 31st, there's not going to be a big difference that we see where we ended the month. It's right over here, 477, 506. Right, so we'll see that little bit of shift. We're gonna stay in the green for this particular trend of properties for sale. However, number of properties sold, we are seeing a month over month decrease. So I want you to look at that. We ended December right over here at 6,206 properties that sold last month, right? We're down. Look at that, number of properties sold down. So we're seeing a little bit more of that inventory, but the number of properties sold are down. A couple of the factors that come into play here. Obviously, we entered the month, right? We entered the month with holiday season. We have seen some shifts with interest rates, right? We've seen some shifts with interest rates. We are also right at the end of the month. We tend to see a lot of that activity happen at the end of the month. That would have been a little bit different in December, considering that the month ends with holidays versus January, where we start with holidays. So all of those things kind of come into play when we are looking at these numbers, but it is highly likely we will still end the month in the red month over month. We look at this same time period a year ago with one caveat. So while we are in the red, down 31.4% number of properties for sale, down 25.9% number of properties sold. Well, yes, this is in the red. We know that there's two factors that we are going to consider here. One of those is obviously we have seen a decline in inventory. That's something that we've been talking about. One of the things that we looked at with the National Association of Realtors is that compared to a year ago when we ended December, inventory, the number of listings was down 20%. Compared to 2 years ago, that decrease was 60%, right? So that is a factor in some of the numbers that we're going to see. And the kind of change in normal seasonality that we experienced in 2020 due to the onset of the pandemic is also going to be a factor here of why this delta, the difference, right, the delta between the two numbers is going to be a bit higher than what we might anticipate normally. All right, looking at our inventory trends, look at this number. So this is really positive. For us to look at here is that month over month, from December 1st through the 30th, from January 1st through the 30th, new listings up 32.1%. That's huge, right? Up 32.1%. We had seen these declines that were happening right over here, right? We can see right over here where we started to experience an increase, right? Where we started to experience an increase in January. We are lower compared to a year ago. So still down 26% compared to a year ago. I just said listings from a year ago, down 20%. From 2 years ago, down 60%. However, from a month over month perspective, we are seeing that kind of increase. So if you're saying, hey, there's no opportunities for listing out there right now, There absolutely are. There are homeowners that are taking action right now. As we go through some of the pricing trends, this is going to be really important. There are a lot of homeowners right now that are saying, whoa, what just happened with the stock market last week? Whoa, what's going on with interest rates? We're starting to see that shift. Whoa, what's going on with the average active price? If you're sharing with them some of these indicators that this market cannot go up forever, right? It can't go up forever. Right now might be the best time for them to take advantage of the equity that they've gained in the last year. That's how we create urgency. And so we'll talk about that. But this is going to be really important that we are seeing the number of new listings. Los Angeles County is up 32.1% from last month, down 26% from a year ago. Pendants down 9.8% from last month and down 19.5% from a year ago. Let's look at these pricing trends. Average active price, right? Average active price down 9.4%. This is important. We have seen a market where, yes, we have experienced record-breaking appreciation of 14% across the median home price in the United States last year. Record-breaking appreciation. We see this average sold price right over here from a year ago in Los Angeles County is up 21.5%. With that being said, a couple of factors that are really important for us to take into consideration when we're looking at this average sold price. We know that in the past 2 years, the majority of homes have sold for over listed price, right? Over that active price, that listed price that was on the market. Many times these homes also sold over appraised value. So the value that the financial institutions have given that asset. What that means is that the average sold price has gone up, but the appraised price might be here. This is part of the reason that we are seeing some challenges with appraisals right now, right? I've mentioned a couple that we've seen just in some of the markets here in our area, just from our office. I've talked to a couple of outside agents who have also experienced significant appraisal issues that are coming in to the tune of, you know, 20 to 90,000, which is kind of what we've seen at 80 and 90 just here in office, right? We're seeing some of those issues, some of those challenges that are coming into play. That's because this appreciated value is not necessarily the value that the appraisers, the financial institutions have given. So that's one of the things that's really important for us to look at is that when we are doing our CMAs, when we're doing pricing, that it's very important that not only are we looking at the comparables of what recently sold, that we are making adjustments in the way that an appraiser would make adjustments, that we are also looking at what properties, the property we are listing is competing against in that market, right? Which is part of why we're seeing this average active price go down. With that being said, we're actually gonna be doing some very interesting classes on pricing in the way that an appraiser does. I think that, you know, as we mentioned, we're having our listing competition, which launches tomorrow, and all the prizes that we have associated with that. And some of those prizes will also be, and some of those points that you can earn are not just going to be around taking listings. Of course, we're going to reward that as well, but also on working on your skill set as it comes to pricing property, from really understanding how to do a high level, you know, competitive market analysis, really understanding how to appraise on the basis of the way that an appraiser would work, right? All that information is going to be so, so important. So a couple of our top producers have just said yes, that they will allow you to kind of see behind the scenes of how they price property in the style of an appraiser. And that's going to be something we talk about because these numbers that we're looking at right over here are so important. With that being said, when we are talking to homeowners, this number, the average sold price, is the biggest opportunity that you have at your disposal to start a great conversation with the homeowner. Simple script. Do you know, Mr. Homeowner, that the average sold price in your area has gone up 21.5% from this same time last year, 14% in the entire US, but 21.5% here in your area? Just out of curiosity, do you know the value of your home? Would you like to, right? That's a very different conversation from asking somebody if they want to sell, right? The majority of the time people will say, well, no, they're going to get you off the phone. The same way that when you walk into a store and somebody says, how can I help you? We say, I'm just looking. When we ask somebody if they want to sell, they say, no, I'm good. I'm not interested in selling right now. And what we don't always realize is that with this average sold price, when they start seeing the amount of appreciation they gained, the conversation may change. And the majority do not know how much their home is worth. I just shared this experience with you guys that we had in our office, a client that was looking at doing a refi, right? They were looking at doing a refinance on their home. They were not interested in selling until they received an unsolicited offer on their home. They said, guess what? We're not doing the refi anymore. We're selling the property, right? Because now money talks, and that money was in front of them. They saw what they could gain on the property. They said, hey, you know what? Right now is going to be the best time to sell. That is going to be really important to utilize those type of techniques and tools as we kind of move forward before we see this potentially shift down. Absorption rates. We saw this kind of double within the last month. Made sense. We saw more properties for sale, means there's more inventory to be had, but this does not significantly move us into any different market. This is still what is historically considered a seller's market, between 1 to 5 months of inventory. 5 to 7 months is considered a balanced market. 7+ is considered a buyer's market. With that being said, does that mean that this is not a great time for buyers to buy? Not necessarily, right? If a buyer can afford their monthly payment, they feel comfortable with it, then it's always potentially a good time to buy, as long as they're not looking at selling the home in 1 to 2 years, right? Whatever happens with the market, we know that prices go up and down on an upward trajectory. Why? Because real estate tends to be finite, right? It is finite. That value is there. Unlike the stock market, which can drop to zero tomorrow, real estate does not do that. It will always have associated value with it. I've shared the story of my grandmother's property bought in 1971 for $36,000, has been through 4 market corrections or market crashes, including the economic recession following 07 and the housing market crash. And yet that property is definitely not worth $36,000 anymore, right? That pricing has gone up over those years, despite those dips in the market. And so that's why it's so important when we look at these absorption rates and we talk about a seller's market versus a buyer's market, is that we educate our clients on what does that really mean? Because just because something is historically a seller's market doesn't necessarily mean that it's a bad time for them to buy. They're making payments towards their rent when they could be making payments towards their equity and gain an asset that in case of emergency, they can buy against, right? They can talk to an accountant about some of the tax benefits of owning property. All of those different things with an asset that appreciates in value over time, where the loan decreases over time, that is a huge, huge opportunity. So we look at the absorption rates because it's important to look at the months of inventory that we have and some of the fluctuations, but this does not move us into a place where it's not necessarily a good time for a client to buy, depending on their unique circumstances. All right, looking at our days on market, we did see a little bit of an increase in the last month on days on market. We've been fluctuating around 21, 22, 23, 24, 25 days on market, a slight growth that we've experienced. Right now we're at about 29. I would say this, just based on the last day that we're going to have right over here, we may see a little bit of this number dip slightly, right? And then sold versus original list price at 99% of list. So average active price is down. Sold versus original list price is also slightly down. The only thing that I look at when I see this, or the only thing that I again, am gonna remind you to anticipate, is making sure that you are setting the expectations prior to your appraisals. All right, moving on over to Orange County. So here we go, county number 2, that we're experiencing the number of properties for sale, see an increase. So we saw this dip, right? The light green is our number of properties for sale. We saw a decline down to 953 as we ended the month of December. Right now, we're at about 1,288 properties in Orange County. So that number is around here, right? We're seeing that number around here. We're seeing that increase again. Looking at properties sold, down 41.6% from last month. So this is actually a decrease. We're more so around here, right over here. We look at this same time period a year ago. Again, we're looking at some of the dips that we've seen in inventory trends, but at the same time, we are also looking at some of the changes that we saw in seasonality in the last 2 years. Number of properties for sale down 48.7%. Number of properties sold down 35.6%. Looking at our inventory trends. So again, right here, when we look at the number of new listings, right? We look at the number of new listings. We are in the green. There is so much opportunity to take listings right now, right? Up 20.1%. From a year ago, we're still seeing that dip down 40.2%. And then pendants down 6.8% month over month and down 37.2% from a year ago. So look at our pricing trends. Here again, we're seeing this average active price is in the red. So what's happening? We're seeing people starting to price a little bit lower than what they're seeing, what the comps are, because we are experiencing those appraisal issues. We want to make sure that we are pricing strategically, right? We're pricing strategically. So down 15.9%, but look at this number from a year ago, up 25.4%. Do you know that the average sold price in your area has gone up 25.4% from this same time a year ago? Just out of curiosity, do you know the value of your home? Would you like to? Would you be offended if I prepared a comparative market analysis for you, or if I prepared a price valuation of your home for you? Absorption rates. Also, again, so that almost double that we're seeing in this absorption rate from 0.4 to 0.9, we're seeing that with the number of homes for sale on the market experience a increase as well. And then last but not least, our days on market and sold versus original list price. So this is a little bit different of what we're experiencing here. No change in average days on market, but look at this sold versus original list price. So one thing I am going to note on this, let's go back right over here. Okay. Average active price is down 15.9%. So we're seeing that average active price decline. The reason that's important is because we've seen that happen for a little bit, you know, more time right over here. Now we're seeing this 100 to 101% of list price. Average active price is lower, but that sold versus original list price is slightly higher. Those are going to start evening out, right? So don't anticipate that all of a sudden homes are selling for, you know, a huge amount. It's we're seeing that average active price go down, and then this sold versus original list price, we're still up a little bit here. So just take that into consideration if you are, you know, representing homeowners or buyers in Orange County, that we are still seeing properties go a little bit over asking. However, we are seeing that asking price start to decline. And then Riverside County, so this is where we start moving into our lower price line. We're still seeing this same trend here. Number of properties for sale, we're in the green, up 9.9%, down 12.1% from a year ago. This delta, this difference, right? The delta is the difference from a year ago is less significant than what we see in some of the other counties. We saw a lot of movement that has occurred and continues to occur in these lower price point counties. Has a lot to do with affordability, right? Affordability kind of changes things. Number of properties sold down month over month, 41.3%. Number of properties sold from a year ago, down 26.4%. Looking at our inventory trends, check this out. Number of new listings, also an increase, up 23.9%. However, we're also seeing the number of pendants go up 3.1%. This has actually been red in our last two counties. Again, these affordability, affordability starts playing a role as we get into our lower price point counties. We see loan types change, right? We see different restrictions that have changed. Obviously, we've seen restrictions that have been much more significant in Los Angeles County that sometimes impact some of this. And we'll talk about one of those being the eviction moratorium as well. Looking at our pricing trends, this average active price is also seeing a decline, but this decline is only 1.7%. So it's not as significant as what we saw in the last two counties. And yet this average sold price, again, we're at the 25.9%. This is talking to homeowners in Riverside County is, do you know that the average sold price in your area has gone up by 25.9% in the last year? Just out of curiosity, do you know the value of your home? Would you like to? Okay, and our absorption rates. So every county, we've seen almost a bit of a double here. Same thing, 0.6 to 1.2. But again, no major fluctuation out of our current market type. And then days on market and sold versus original list price here in Riverside County. So average days on market, we're seeing a bit of an increase. Here, this is gonna be really important. Sold versus original list price, down 5%, 95 from 100%. We see average active prices decline slightly, but this sold versus original list price difference of 5%. Appraisal issues. I want you guys to really think about appraisals, really think about making sure that you are stacking the deck in your favor. Like I mentioned, I'm in Riverside County. We had a property that within the last, it's going to be last 7 weeks now, appraised $90,000 below, right? Below the purchase price. Now, we were still able to get it closed, which is great, negotiated through that. However, a $90,000 decrease in that appraisal, that difference, that delta could make or break a deal, right? Those are the things that really can break a deal. When you are getting your property appraised, a couple things that are really important, regardless of what side of the transaction you're on, whether you're on the seller side, you never want to overpromise. Hey, we got an offer and it was $60,000 above. So great, we're going to get $60,000 more. No, right? We want to say, hey, we got this great offer and we don't want to count on that additional income until we've gotten past the appraisal process, until we get to close. Hopefully the property will appraise or we try to negotiate that difference. And this could be something that causes negotiation later in the transaction. We set that expectation up front so we don't have that struggle of then getting the client to agree later on, because now they have an expectation that is above what the numbers in the market are actually supporting. On the buyer side, really making sure that we're anticipating that there is a possibility that the property will not appraise and they will be asked to come out with that difference. Is that something that they are not only open to, but are they willing and able to do that as well, right? So that they don't have that expectation. Now all of a sudden they're money in the hole from doing an inspection, from doing an appraisal, and suddenly the appraisal is much too low and they can't proceed with that transaction. We want to set that expectation at the beginning. Other things that are really important around this time frame, if we're setting that expectation with the client that, hey, this may happen, there are some additional things we can do. As an example, a couple of the inspection vendors that we work with offer a slight increase in the initial payment to, if that way that if the client falls out of escrow, they now have a discounted inspection on the next property. That might be something that we're looking at when we're not sure what's going to go on with the appraisal. How do we stack the appraisal? How do we stack the deck in our favor in appraisal? I've mentioned this before. Take the first page of your purchase agreement, the page that is the last final purchase price with that purchase price highlighted, at least three comparables that support your purchase price in the method that an appraiser is going to use, preferably within the last 3 months, if not sooner, that are within 15% square footage difference max on the home, 15% square footage difference max on the lot, and are within 1 mile, notwithstanding any major shifts from zip code, major streets, freeways, right, changes in the school district, et cetera. We always want to kind of look at those as our baseline for what we're including. And it doesn't hurt to take a cup of coffee to the appraiser, right? It's not to say that they're going to represent one way or the other, but we try to make their job a little bit easier to stack the deck in our favor. So this is pretty significant here, 5%. All right, San Bernardino going into our lowest price point county. This is the only county of the four that we have just gone over that the number of properties for sale month over month is actually in the red. And yet from a year ago is in the green, up 27.5%. Number of properties sold from last month, down 42.6%. Number of properties sold from last year, down 25.1%. Only one we're in the red here. San Bernardino inventory trends. We're seeing, again, an increase in the number of new listings. Smallest increase across the four counties of only 2%, right? Of listings going up only 2%, down 16.9% from a year ago. Number of properties pended down 18.8% month over month, down 14.1% from a year ago. What about these pricing trends? Also, an average active price decline, but this is also the smallest decline. Riverside County was pretty low at 2%, but here's a decline of only 1%, not a major decline here. And yet we're also seeing this average sold price still up at 22.1%. I would still be utilizing some of that conversation in San Bernardino County of, hey, do you know that the average sold price in your area has gone up 22.1% over the course of the last year? Just out of curiosity, do you know the value of your home? Would you like to, right? That's the conversation starter script. Now, once we're actually in the conversation and pricing those properties, I do want to talk about this average active price because that creates urgency. We know the average active price, the properties getting listed on the market is going down. And the average sold versus original list price number is going down like we're seeing in some of these counties. How long is a homeowner going to wait to take advantage of this equity that they've gained over the course of the last year, right? That's an urgency factor. All right. And looking at our absorption rates, again, we're seeing an increase here in months of inventory. Not as significant, again, as what we saw in the last three counties. It went from 0.8 to 1.3. All of the three other counties look to be at about 98 to 120%. This one's at 65.5%. Doesn't move us into a significant change in market. We are still in what is traditionally considered a seller's market at 1.3 months of inventory. And then our days on market, small shift. And then look at this, from 101% to 100%. So we've seen kind of this decline in every county except for Orange County, where we saw that number kind of go up. We just want to be cognizant as we're going in again to those appraisal situations. We want to make sure we're watching that. All right, so let's go into some of our industry updates. You guys know we've been talking about do the database too. Some of the things we're going to talk about as we go into our industry updates. These are the opportunities that you have to educate your clients, to inform your clients, to have a conversation that is geared to start a dialogue. Right? Not just to go and ask everybody, hey, who wants to buy or sell and move on to the next one, right? We want to create dialogue because that's what earns us the relationship. That's what earns us the referrals. That's what earns us the future business. With that being said, as you are doing your follow-up, we know that we experience call bias sometimes in which we only call the people that are top of mind for us. That's why Do the Database 2 is so important. In Do the Database 2, week number 4, which is the week we're on now, we're calling those individuals in our phone, in our database that have a last name starting with H or V, right? H or V, so that we don't miss anybody. You can still do your call bias calls that you're gonna do, but so that you don't skip people, also call those that have a last name of H or V. All right, forbearances, foreclosures, NODs, industry updates, a couple things. We have talked about a lot of people that have been curious of, are we going to see a ton of foreclosures coming on the market? The answer is not likely, right? While we will still see some NODs and trustee sales, there is too much going on that is going to kind of limit the amount of properties that we can anticipate coming on the market. One of those, we saw, of course, an increase in forbearances. So in loan forbearances where individuals were not paying their rent. The current active forbearance number for those individuals that are still in some type of mortgage forbearance is below 1 million for the nation. When we looked at the housing bubble burst 2005 to 2008, right, at 2008, so the major shift happening in 2007, but in 2008, there were 10 million homeowners in the United States that lost their home to foreclosure. There are less than 1 million homes in active forbearance right now. Now, let's look at, and there's also a lot of equity in the market. So in that time period when there was these 10 million homeowners that lost their home and went to foreclosure, a lot of them did not have significant equity in their home, which meant we saw a lot of short sales. And it's not the case. We've seen record-breaking appreciation over the course of the last year. That is not the case anymore. With that being said, we look at California specifically. California's mortgage relief program came out right at the beginning of the year. There is over $1 billion that has been set aside for this program. Those eligible applicants must be at 100% of their county area's median income or lower, own an SFR, condo, or permanently affixed manufactured home, and have pandemic-related financial hardship. The grants that are available are up to $80,000 grant programs, right, to help them with their mortgage relief. With that being said, if their financial institution is offering them and they qualify for things like loan modifications, then they will not be able to get access to this program. If their financial institution has said, we're not going to use this mortgage relief program, we don't want to use it, then they're not able to utilize the program as well. This is a great kind of conversation starter with your clients. For those that need California mortgage relief, this is a good conversation starter for them. All right, appreciation and inventory. Median home sales price grown 14% year over year to an all-time high in 2021. This is the biggest increase that we have ever seen in a single year, right? In a single year in a home price in the United States, in the history of real estate. That's a huge increase, right? I want to share something from the book Shift, because I'm going to note, you are going to see a lot more of Shift on the calendar as we move forward. And the reason is this. Shift happens. So this is on page 7 of Shift. Shift is how top real estate agents tackle tough times. Now, I'm going to know, am I saying we're in tough times right now? No. However, we know there's no way to really figure out when a shift is going to come, and it's always better to be prepared. So on page 7 of Shift, Gary Keller says, real estate is a cyclical business. What goes up must come down, and what is down won't stay there. Shifts are never unexpected, but rarely predictable. You know one is coming, you just don't know when. They are, in fact, inevitable. Shifts happen, but we forget. Each time a shift occurs, we act surprised as if it has never happened before. Once the shift is over, we act as if it'll never happen again. It's like we have amnesia, and that's odd since we deal with something similar every year. It's called seasonality, the seasonal cycle of sales that repeats each and every year. From month to month, there is an ebb and flow to the real estate business. Within each year, there is time to make money and time to save money. It is so natural, most simply take it in stride. I bring this up right now because, one, I think there's so many things that are happening in this real estate market as it relates to appreciation, things that we've seen with the stock market, all of these different things that happen that are all indicators that something is coming, because we saw a median home sale price appreciation of 14% in a single year. That is not sustainable. That is not sustainable, right? If you study compound money at all, it is simply not sustainable. It can't just happen forever. It can't go up forever. There's also been extremely tight supply due to years of underbuilding. So might we still see prices continue to go up for a little while? Yes, we may, right? Because there is still a very low amount of inventory. And as we see the economy begin to recover, we are going to see changes with the interest rates, right? Those are going to be different things that happen. There's changes that we're going to see with census data. We also have an entirely new community of people based on census data that are now moving into purchasing power, into purchasing age, right? Or purchasing power. So there's a lot of these different factors as it relates to demographic information, as it relates to how much inventory is available just based on the building that are occurring. And yet we know that at some point something will happen. And so we want to prep for those things. A couple of things that are relevant updates around this. We know that California specifically is taking legislative action to create inventory. Senate Bill 9 and 10, which is meant to basically eliminate single family housing and create opportunities. Senate Bill 9 to create up to 4-unit properties. Senate Bill 10 to create up to 10-unit properties on homes that were originally designated for single-family residents. That's part of it. California Housing Element, which is part of the general plan for every single city, right? For every single city in California, has this new allocation based on the census data from last year that says you city, whatever city, have to create X amount of new housing over the course of the next year. Downey has to create about 6,500 additional homes over the course of the next year. So where do they do that? Rezoning and Senate Bill 9 and 10, right, is going to be a big part of that. Now, with that being said, I also talked about this last week, Carson, Torrance, Redondo Beach, and there may be some other cities that have joined on since last week, are now joining a legal effort to basically eliminate this Senate bill, right? That it violates local control of land use. So we'll see what that effect is. But what we know is that in certain areas, this will again delay the new construction, right? It's gonna delay some of that construction. Now, where else have we anticipated inventory to come in? A lot of people have been talking about a couple things here, that there's a lot of people, a lot of sellers that are in your pipeline that have been waiting until they can remove the tenants. And I know it because I get those calls all the time. We're just waiting until we can evict the tenants so that we can sell the property, et cetera, right? Because the majority, a lot of who we have as buyers in the market right now are looking for owner-occupied. We've seen that really grow, right? People that are looking for owner-occupied are getting loans that are owner-occupied loans. Now, if you can't remove tenants, all of a sudden you have no option for owner-occupied on that particular property. You have to sell it tenant in place. As of last week, the LA County Board of Supervisors has extended the COVID-19 Tenant Protection Act. Let's talk a little bit about that. I think that's important to kind of look at. I'm going to be sharing a couple of things around this. What does this extend? So this is going to extend certain things. Now, there's a couple different dates on this, right? There's different phases to this tenant protection resolution. Phase number one, which goes from February 1st, so it starts tomorrow, to May 31st of 2022. This is going to extend protections for residential tenants and mobile home space renters. This includes a rent increase fee freeze for rent stabilized units in unincorporated areas of the county. This includes protections for evictions for no fault eviction reasons. Listen to this, except for qualified owner move-in. So there are some opportunities here, right? There are some opportunities here, which is why I wanted to bring this up. Protection against evictions for nuisance, unauthorized occupants or pets, or denying entry to a landlord. Anti-harassment and retaliation protections for all residential mobile home space renters and commercial tenants. So that piece includes commercial tenants. Personal guarantee protections for smaller 0 to 9 employees, commercial tenants. So there are some commercial pieces to this tenant protections. This is gonna add, as of April 1st, 2022, this adds eviction protections for non-payment of rent, including self-certification to establish affirmative defense for all residential and mobile home space renters due to COVID-19 financial hardship for rent incurred on or after April 1st, 2022. However, it lifts non-payment of rent eviction protections for commercial tenants that expires January 31st, 2022. So commercial tenants do not have the same protections that on non-payment of rent as of today. Now, phase two, which goes June 1st, 2022 to December 31st, 2022. This is gonna extend protection for residential tenants and mobile home space renters continue through December 1st, 2022, which includes rent increase freeze for rent stabilized units in unincorporated areas of the county, protections for no fault eviction reasons. Again, except for qualified owner move-in, nuisance and unauthorized occupants or pets, anti-harassment and retaliation protections for all residential mobile home space renters and commercial tenants. And again, a personal guarantee protection for smaller 0 to 9 employee commercial tenants. It amends right? It amends as of effective June 1st, 2022, eviction protection for non-payment of rent, including self-certification to establish affirmative defense for households with income at or below 80% area median income only due to COVID-19 financial hardship for rent incurred on or after April 1st, 2022. And it lists the following protections. Okay. Protection against eviction for denying entry to landlord, especially when entry constitutes harassment, and owner move-ins. It removes the purchase date 6/30/2021 requirement and requirement that tenants not be financially impacted by COVID-19 for owner move-ins to occur. There's a lot more that goes into place with this new, with this new tenant protections resolution. I am going to be posting this in the hub, right? In the hub, I'm going to be posting this PDF that outlines not just what we went through, but it's going to outline, you know, a lot of question and answer around this. This is a huge bill, but the part that is going to be really interesting to look at is when we look at this item about qualified owner move-in, right? About qualified owner move-in. There is still opportunity there. If you have owners, if you have homeowners, buyers that are like, hey, we really are interested in taking this particular property, but the property has tenants in place, right? There's going to be some really unique ways to deal with that. And that's going to be something that's really important. So we'll do a class that is very specific to this kind of new tenant protection resolution, because this is a major kind of change right now. There is this extension, but these pieces on really having an understanding of what does qualified owner move-in entail for your clients is going to be really important here. The other piece that I want to note here is obviously we talked about appreciation, and yet I mentioned I want you to continue to monitor and expect lower appraisals and learn which programs might help your buyer clients to increase affordability. With that being said, a couple of those items, right? A couple of the opportunities that this information gives us. Generate conversations with homeowners. A lot of the content that I'm giving you, you can create social media pieces on. Doesn't mean you need to have all the answers. Just reference what website does. For mortgage relief, call every homeowner in your database and talk to them about mortgage relief. What does that conversation look like? It's, hey, so-and-so, you know, I just wanted to give you a call. I'm calling all of the homeowners that are in, you know, my network, because obviously you're somebody that I care about. I just wanted to inquire, is mortgage assistance or mortgage relief something that might be needed for you? Because there's a great mortgage relief program with California right now that I can connect you with. They're either going to say yes, and you're going to earn a ton of goodwill, or they're going to say no, which goes into a conversation like this. I completely understand that. By the way, I don't know if you know this, but the median home sales price has risen over 14% in the last year to an all-time high. Just out of curiosity, do you know the value of your home? Would you like to? Or if they're a recent homeowner, you may want to ask them, you know, hey, I totally understand you just moved into the property, you know, within the last year. There's a great, if they have mortgage insurance, right? There's a great MI Buster program. That if you have 10% equity, a 680 plus FICO score, and have been in the property for at least 6 months, we can potentially eliminate your mortgage insurance. Would that be something you'd be interested in getting more information on, right? Is now you're giving them value. You're giving them value. Here's the finish on that conversation is great. You know what? I'm really glad that you're in a great place and you don't necessarily need mortgage assistance or the MI Buster program. Don't need to get the value of your home. Just out of curiosity, who do you know that might need this information that you can connect me with, right? This is where we get referrals. We grow our database. This is a huge opportunity right now to call the homeowners. And this is a way different conversation than, hey, do you want to buy, sell, or invest in real estate, right? We're coming in with value. We're coming in with value. You are solidifying your place as the expert when it comes to real estate for this client, so that no matter what, when they have a real estate related question, even if it's not right now, you are the only person that they call. That's the only secret in this business, is that when people, you have to have enough people in your world that when they think of real estate, they think of you and find you the most credible and They trust that you have their best interests at heart. And this conversation is how we do that. With that being said, absentee owners, right? Absentee owners, this eviction moratorium is a great opportunity to generate interest in those that are saying, I guarantee that there are some owners sitting at home right now and saying, oh my gosh, I don't know what I'm going to do. I think I should just sell. And what they don't know is they can potentially sell tenant in place as an option, or you can look at some of the options for owner qualified move-in. And as a listing agent, might it not behoove you to include some information about owner occupied move-in for your clients at list so that you can open up the property to additional opportunity. For opportunity two, generate conversations with buyers, right? Generating conversations with the buyers in your database. Call every single buyer in your pipeline. We know affordability is an issue right now, as is interest rates, as we start seeing interest rates change, right? Two conversations here is, might we want to discuss some of the new down payment assistance programs that are available or back, right? And are a little bit more accessible because we're starting to see inventory sit a little bit longer, right? We're starting to see more inventory come on the market. Not a ton, but we are seeing a little bit more inventory. So there's a little more flexibility here. Also discussing changes in interest rates to create urgency, right? How long is somebody going to wait to take advantage of the interest rates as they stand right now? And then opportunity three, thinking about housing element and Senate Bill 9 and 10, research and identify the opportunity in your farm. If you are working a geographic farm, whatever that might be, it is going to behoove you to have information about housing element, to know the numbers, create some social media content, talk to your clients about these things, right? Talk to your clients about these things, because this is a huge, huge opportunity for those that maybe are interested in building, right? But also for those that are saying, hey, you know what? This isn't something that I wanna deal with. I'd rather just sell my property. And now I feel like there's more opportunity. Okay. A couple things that I just wanna point out for you. The February social media calendar is out. Right? The February social media calendar is out and available for you on Outfront Magazine. We'll also make sure that we post this out for you as well. Family reunion. If you're planning to attend family reunion with us, this is going to be a huge, huge event. There is a digital ticket of $129. Early bird pricing goes up after this week for the in-person event. So I just wanted to go ahead and point that out. They are limiting the number of people that will be at family reunion this year live, because of COVID-19. So they wanna make sure they have the best protections in place. So this will be limited, my friends. With that being said, keynote speaker, Sean Aker, he wrote The Happiness Advantage, Before Happiness and Big Potential, some great books. This is gonna be a good one. So he will, we'll make sure we highlight some of the stuff from his video as well. I also wanna talk about a couple of the segments for you. One, sports and entertainment. The application process, if sports entertainment is something you're interested in, is currently open for phase two of those that are going to be eligible for sports and entertainment. If you are interested in applying, please come see me. Also, Keller Concierge, we've talked about, if you went to the fix and flip program, we now have a ready to sell program, a ready to stay program, and a cash offer program that you can utilize in your listing presentations. In order to do so, you must get certified. The website is app.kelleroffers.com to go through the certification process. I want to know why this is such a phenomenal program. We are extremely, extremely blessed. And what I mean by that is we are one of the first KW offices in Los Angeles County and Riverside County to get access to the Keller Offers program. Because of a unique relationship we have with the general contractor and having them on site here in our office. If this is something that you want to add to your listing presentation, you must go through the certification process. And then we're going to be having a fix and flip class again, so our secondary one, to talk about some of this understanding on the ready to sell program, how to really analyze the property for some of the cosmetic challenges that are going to allow you to sell that property for top dollar, and how to present that for your client. Huge, huge. Also, commercial, KW Commercial there is a ton of new resources that are now available starting next month for KW Commercial. This is going to get launched out at Family Reunion, and I wanted you to be the first to know. There are some brand new, phenomenal products that are coming through. If commercial is something that is of interest to you, Nucleus is one of the best commercial industry leading training programs that I have seen for commercial. This used to be outside of Keller Williams. It is now a partnership with Keller Williams. This is a game changer if commercial real estate is something of interest to you. Also, the product deck is changing a little bit. Real Next is an amazing product that is available for really managing everything as it relates to commercial, from understanding the back end management of property, the marketing pieces. I mean, this is a huge asset for those that are interested in commercial. And of course, the other thing I want to note, because this is going to be huge, we as an office, we have a contract with CoStar, the commercial multiple listing service. We now have national access, right? We now have national access, and we have discounted access to CoStar. This is a huge tool for you. Trust me when I say, if you are interested in commercial and CoStar is going to be that next piece, please come talk to us. I believe we have a seat right now for our commercial CoStar account. Please come talk to us and we'll get you all set up with that as well, my friends. And last but not least, our Keller Williams School of Real Estate. If you are looking at getting your friends and family into the real estate industry, we do now offer a free real estate school. Please connect with Jose or myself, and we can definitely get your friends, family, and network into the real estate school. It is online, provided through Kaplan University, which is a phenomenal education platform. And it is 100% free for anyone that is interested in taking real estate classes. There is also a 20% discount for any continuing education credits for when you need to do your CE credits as well. With that, I know that was a lot of information, my friends. A couple things that I just want to note that we're going to have coming out on the schedule. Let me go to stop share. A couple things that are going to be coming out on the schedule. We are doing an Ignite at Night. We're going to be launching the date shortly. However, we're editing it a little bit. Right? We're editing a little bit. And what do I mean by that? Ignite at Night is a phenomenal foundational course. And we're going to be bringing some top producers in for some of the sessions to share some extended content. Like I mentioned, pricing, appraisals, right? CMAs, a lot of those different things is going to be really important. Listing presentation, being able to conduct a listing presentation in either English or Spanish, because we have those available for you as well. All of those different elements are part of what we are going to be covering. We are bringing back the fix and flip class, right? We're going to be doing that again. And there's some really cool site visits that we're looking at adding to that. There's going to be a lot of things that are on the calendar that we are getting situated for you. Please keep an eye. And I know that this week, today and tomorrow, we are finishing up with the Steve Ryder class, right? For those of you that are taking in the morning, phenomenal class, my friends. So with that, keep an eye on the calendar and we will talk to you soon. I hope you guys have an absolutely phenomenal rest of your day. Bye, my friends.